Thank you. Good evening, friends. Welcome to Christmas Eve worship at First Unitarian Church of Orlando. I'm Samuel Schaal, Transition Minister. These familiar words from Sophia Lyon Foss call us together as we light our chalice. Each night a child is born is a holy night, a time for singing, a time for wondering, and a time for worshiping. Before we get started in worship tonight, a couple of announcements. First, it's a tradition in our congregation to take up an offering in the Christmas Eve service to benefit one of our community partners, an outside organization that does important work in the wider community. Tonight, we've chosen Second Harvest Food Bank, and an important work in these days of the virus where there's an unprecedented need to feed the hungry in our communities. So we ask you to give as generous of a gift as you can give. As you see here, there are multiple ways to give. You can give through the church, either go on our website and click the donate button and give that way, or send a check, or go to Second Harvest website directly and give a gift. Again, it's important work, and we want to help as best we can. Thank you for your generosity. And second, we gather tonight, we invite you to gather tonight into fellowship after this service in a separate Zoom room using a separate link, as you see. It's the same link that we use for fellowship following our Sunday worship services, but here it is if you need it. Both of these slides on Second Harvest offering and on the fellowship following will be repeated at the end of this service. I'm so glad that we can all be here tonight. We miss meeting in person, but we gather in this rather remarkable medium of online worship, still able to be with each other and to worship. Some of you have been in the church for a long time. This is your spiritual home. This place is familiar to you and its traditions are familiar. Some of you are newer and are finding your way into our community. And some of you are perhaps brand new, maybe even this is your first visit. If so, we want to welcome you in your search for a place of wonder, of soul, of depth, of connection, and of joy. So, whoever you are, wherever you are on your journey, you are welcome here, for we have made a place for you, that tonight, perchance, the infancy of holiness might find birth in your heart. Come, let us worship together.
Thank you. Good evening. I'm Sarah Gray, religious educator here at First Unitarian Church of Orlando. I want to wish you all a Merry Christmas and hope that you and yours are having a safe, healthy, and happy holiday in Christmas Eve this evening. So tonight we share and celebrate the story of the birth of Jesus, which happened on a Christmas Eve many, many years ago. I invite you and your family to stand and follow the motions as me and my family share an interactive version of the Nativity story.
This is the star in the sky. These are the shepherds watching by night that saw the star in the sky. This is the angel shining bright who came to the shepherds watch by night that saw the star in the sky. This is the mother with precious load, trudging the long and weary road. Looked on by the angel shining bright, who came to the shepherds watching by night, that saw the star in the sky. This is the inn where the only room was a stable out in the lamplit gloom. For the mother and her precious load, who trudged the long and weary road, looked on by the angel shining bright, who came to the shepherds watch by night, that saw the star in the sky. This is the sheep who shared her stall, and saw such wonders with a deepening awe. At the darkened inn where the only room was the stable out in the lamp-lit gloom. For the mother and her precious load, who trudged the long and weary road. Looked on by the angel shining bright, who came to the shepherds watching by night, that saw the star in the sky. This is the manger warm with hay, wherein a newborn baby lay. This is the sheep who shared her stall and saw such wonders with deepening awe. At the darkened inn where the only room was the stable out in the lamplit gloom. For the mother and her precious load, who trudged the long and weary road, looked on by the angel shining bright, who came to the shepherds watching by night, that saw the star in the sky.
Bye. Thank you for sharing that story with us. Indeed, every night a child is born is a night to be celebrated, much like the night of the birth of Jesus was celebrated far and wide. It's a tale that's familiar and well known to many of us. We have the usual cast of characters. We have Mary and Joseph and baby Jesus. We have the angels, we have the shepherds, and we have the wise men. But something so powerful of the story of Christmas in general is that it's not just the well-known or the good or the righteous who celebrate the birth. All creatures of this world, the creatures who, fairly or unfairly, may have been deemed great and beautiful or beastly or overlooked or small, all of these creatures are worthy, they are loved, and they are allowed to participate, celebrate, and be included. Please join me as we read We Were There, a Nativity Story by Eve Bunting.
We Were There, a Nativity Story by Eve Bunting. Paintings by Wendell Miner. I am snake. I sleep when it is cold, but not tonight. Tonight I cross the wintry desert, the curving snake of sand that follows me shows me where I have been. Soon I will be there. I am toad, fat, warty, rough. My toes have webs between, but I can leap small leaps and crawl and sprawl. I will be there. I am scorpion. I clatter over rocks through black ravines, my curved tail up and forward on my back. I will not use my sting tonight. I will be there. I am cockroach, shiny, shelled. I've known the hiding places of the earth since time began. I will be there. I am bat. I swoop, dark-shadowed, in a loop of silence. I do not need the light of that new star to show me where. I will be there. I am spider. I spin my webs and hang on shimmering threads that carry me from tamarisk to olive tree. I'm fast, especially if there is wind. And if there is no wind, and if there are no trees on that bleak hill, I'll walk. I'll follow them. I will be there. I am rat, colorless as darkening dirt. I know this inn. Nightly I scrabble on the floor for scraps. I squeeze beneath the door tonight. I slide through stable straw. And I am there. In times to come, they'll talk about the silent night, the donkey, and the cows, so generous to share their place. The little lambs, as soft as lilies of the field, the woman, swollen, waiting. No one will look beyond the light of darkness and the corner where we watch, unwatched. They will not know or care. But we were there.
Thank you. Reading titled Big Bird and Baby Jesus. It was written a long time ago by Rev Russ of Florida. Once, when our son was just 3 years old, during the various December holidays of light, I put out our normal nativity scene like I had always done before. The morning I set that up, I woke up, walked into the living room, and saw that our son had gotten up earlier and put all his Sesame Street figures in a ring around the Holy Family and the lowing cattle. He loved playing with those interdenominational figures. Mary didn't seem to mind when Bert and Ernie went shopping with her newborn babe. The Sesame Christmas combo worked for us, so we left it that way. The wise men even traveled all over the house during the holidays, courtesy of our son. The next December, we had the Holy Family and livestock, the Sesame Street crowd, and all the Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles who came to see the baby Jesus. It was that December our new cat started snacking on the wise men and hiding the baby Jesus. Every morning we had to look for him anew. Charlie the cat never left Jesus in the same place twice. Then all the characters stayed the same, but the manger became the bridge of the Enterprise. We later added Star Trek figures for security purposes. The cat still hid the baby Jesus every night anyway. Another season, all the angels were actually X-Men characters led by Professor X using his futuristic wheelchair. We also kept adding any small figures that we could find with a visible disability. As I am disabled, including that community is important. Now, we know we are on extremely loose theological ground when we add Scarlett O'Hara, McDonald's, a Ben and Jerry's ice cream truck, and the like to our stable scene. But the scene always reflects the life we live between December celebrations. Every year, our stable reflects what is new with us since last year. We have not forgotten the original story and its participants. Indeed, we now have three Jesuses and three Marys, backups because of the cat. Our lowing cattle look like Noah's Ark story instead. The figures we add remind us of the past year's surmountable problems. And we know that the light of all the December festivals is not in our built-to-scale plug-in McDonald's, but rather in our hearts, even when we cannot see each other, and especially when we can't. Time to add the manatees.
And now a time for mindfulness, meditation, and prayer. Our meditation tonight is from an ancient text brought to us this evening by Reverend Marnie, and I will follow with a prayer.
This piece was written by Fra Giovanni on Christmas Eve, 1513. I salute you. I am your friend. And my love for you goes deep. There is nothing I can give you which you have not, but there is much, very much, that while I cannot give it, you can take. No heaven can come to us unless our hearts find rest in it today. Take heaven. No peace lies in the future which is not hidden in the present little instant. Take peace. The gloom of the world is but a shadow. Behind it, yet within reach, is joy. There is radiance and glory in darkness could we but see. And to see, we have only to look. I beseech you to look. Life is so generous a giver, but we, judging its gifts by their covering, cast them away as ugly or heavy or hard. Remove the covering, and you will find beneath it a living splendor, woven of love by wisdom with power. Welcome it, grasp it, and you touch the angel's hand that brings it to you. Everything we call a trial, a sorrow, or a duty, believe me, that angel's hand is there. The gift is there, and the wonder of an overshadowing presence. Your joys, too. Be not content with them as joys. They, too, conceal diviner gifts. Life is so full of meaning and purpose, so full of beauty beneath its covering, that you will find earth but cloaks your heaven. Courage then to claim it. That is all. But courage you have, and the knowledge that we are pilgrims together, wending through unknown country, home. And so at this time I greet you not quite as the world sends greetings, but with profound esteem, and with the prayer that for you, now and forever, the day breaks and the shadows flee away.
Spirit of life, spirit of love, in these days of dark and shadows, of distance and separation, of fear, of searching, of hoping. We are seeking Christmas, searching in this season for a hidden door to a forgotten room in the house of our very heart. In that Bethlehem of our hearts, we might there find a love so brilliant, so blinding, so surprising, the possibility of radical love made manifest among creation. Fill us each with hope and good cheer, and grant that each one be surrounded by those by whom they are loved, even in spirit if separated by distance, that there, in the joyous tumult of the season, we pray that you speak a word of encouragement and grace to every human heart. And so it is, and so it shall be. Amen. Blessed be.
It's a season of grace coming out of the void, where man is saved by a voice in the distance. It's a season of possible miracle cures, where hope is currency and death is not the last unknown. Time begins to fade, and age is welcome home. It's a season of eyes meeting over the noise, and holding fast with sharp realization. It's the season of cold making warmth and divine, are safe here, you know now. Don't forget, I love you.
This reading is called What Are You Here For? By the Reverend Quinn G. Caldwell. If you came to this place expecting a tame story, you came to the wrong place. If you came for a story that does not threaten you, you came for a different story than the one that we tell. If you came to hear of the coming of a God who only showed up so that you could have a nice day with your loved ones, then you came for a God whom we do not worship here. For even a regular baby is not a tame thing. And goodness that cannot threaten complacency and evil is not much good at all. And a God who would choose to give up power and invincibility to become an infant for you certainly didn't do it just so you could have dinner. But if you came because you think that unwed teenage mothers are some of the strongest people in the world, if you came because you think that the kind of people who work third shift doing stuff you'd rather not do might attract an angel's attention before you, snoring comfortably in your bed, would. If you came because you think there are wise people to be found among undocumented travelers from faraway lands, and they might be able to show you God. If you came to hear a story of tyrants trembling while heaven comes to peasants. If you came because you believe that God loves the animals as much as the people, and so made them the first witnesses to the saving of the world. If you came for a story of reversals that might end up reversing you. If you came for a tale of adventure and bravery, where strong and gentle people win, and the powerful and violent go down to dust, where the rich lose their money but find their lives, and the poor are raised up like kings. If you came to be reminded that God loves you too much to leave you unchanged, if you came to follow the light, even if it blinds you, if you came for salvation and not safety, then, my friends, you are in the right place.
From one of the readings in the back of our hymn book for the season, a summation of the story of the birth from the Gospel of Luke. And it came to pass in those days that there went out a decree from Caesar Augustus that all the world should be taxed. And Joseph also went up from Galilee unto the city of David, which is called Bethlehem, to be taxed with Mary, his espoused wife, being great with child. And so it was that while they were there, the days were accomplished that she should be delivered. And she brought forth her firstborn son, and wrapped him in swaddling clothes, and laid him in a manger, because there was no room for them in the inn. No room for the birth of the holy in that old story. In this old sacred story, we get a hint of what kind of world the baby was born into, a world that was dark, cold, and dangerous. So the birth of the sacred is found in a backward town in a primitive time, born where it was least expected. This season's story tells us not so much an historical truth, but a truth that speaks of our existential need to find the goodness, the holiness in all creation, and most especially, perhaps, in ourselves. The story says something about how in the most difficult circumstances, the good is still there, that out of the hopeless can come hope, that out of darkness can come light, that out of the temporal might emerge the eternal, that out of the profane comes the spiritual idea of the holy breaking into human experience and human consciousness. Not in a literal way, but in a universal way. One meaning of Christmas, then, is the idea of the birth of the holy in needy places, in unholy places. So it suggests that our experience, our lives, all life, is made sacred. And it's also, I think, more than that. It's more than a warm feeling that we are connected to each other and to a source of good in the world. If you follow the story of the rabbi and prophet Jesus from this story, from the birth narrative, through his adult ministry, his difficult death at the hands of the state and the religious authorities, and the remembered resurrection among his followers, and we must see the arc of the complete story to avoid the merely sentimental aspect of religion in this story tonight. We see a prophet who welcomed those the world shunned, who loved all, even his enemies, who drank wine, who loved children, who laughed, who cried, who confronted the principalities and the powers and the politics of his day, who reflected his own glory back to his followers, telling them that they would do greater things than him, that they should heal the sick, raise the dead, cleanse the lepers, to not put their light under a bushel basket. So the story suggests both a transformational inner spirituality and a connectional, authentic social ethic. Now, this story can be interpreted in a lot of ways. I'm not suggesting I've got it right for all time. And this is not the only story of this season or of other seasons. There are other prophets, other points of view, other philosophies of the theologies. But in this story for tonight, we witness a story of a love that birthed a vulnerable baby and transformed the world. A love that is both within us and in the world. a light perhaps in us and in the world. And so we honor light on this dark night. We light candles to remind us of our inner light and to bring more light to the world. Merry Christmas, friends. Peace on earth and goodwill to all. So may it be. Amen.